PhD student here at London University, and I also work at the International Relations Office, where I'm in charge of international projects and student mobility. I know a few of them, at least I've seen a few of them. Somebody came to my office for a consultation about the Erasmus program, which is mobility, and some of them I think also delivered to you some classes. Actually, this lecture is delivered in the framework of a project that London University is doing, and it's financed by the European Union. Here, this is a poster, you can see. So, that is about the project that we have. And in this project, we have to deliver classes which are linked with the European Union. My part in the project is to explain to students what the European Union does in the field of education. And you, as a let's say, specialist in political science, you could be interested in this topic because education, it's also a topic that is kind of linked with policy, with educational policy, let's say. I have one question. This is the third year of the project, so it's the third time I'm delivering this class. I remember who attended in the past this. It's the first time you're attending this. Last year or no? Okay, so let's start. And that's just I'm asking because maybe not the people that need that place there. Okay, let's start from, I want to ask you a question. Okay, this is the theme of the classes of today. And the core word here, the keyword is soft power. I would like to ask you if you know what is that.
It is the ability to attract.
Mm-hmm. Okay, it's ability to attract, okay, it's good. Somebody would like to add some information, it's good. Good point. So?
I think it's just something like a form of realization of states or interests.
Okay, so yes. Yes, it's also state interest. Also, this is another point. Okay.
It's the ability to influence without using hard.
Great.
I mean, the wars or armed conflicts. Soft power is using language, history, culture.
Yes, that's great. Great. Yes, basically you all said through things which are yes, correct. Yes, soft power is something. It's a power to attract. So let others do what you want, like to achieve, but without the use of force, without hard power. So. What do you think it is art power?
Direct propaganda? Or? На русском повторить вопрос, я, может быть, попробую ответить.
А какая есть комбинация сила и как антонима?
Антоним жесткая сила.
Жесткая сила. Что такое жесткая сила? What is art power?
Но это различные могут к этому быть отнести военные действия.
Yes, it's true. It's like the use of war.
Я правильно ответил?
Правильно. Молодец. That's true, yes. Hard power is the use of military, yes. Army. Okay. Have a question. Do you know who elaborated the concept of soft power? Which political scientist?
Joseph Nye.
Great. Okay. And according to Joseph Nye, the soft power is composed by three main elements, which are here. I would like to hear your comments. So we have, according to Joseph Nye, the three concepts, the three resources that a state, what an organ, okay, let's say a state should have to exert soft power are culture, political values, and the foreign policy. What does it mean, according to you, your opinion?
А на русском можете сказать вопрос? Я просто английский не знаю,
поэтому... Да-да-да. Согласно Джозеф Ная, который это политический, как называется, political science, это политический ученый, исследователь, мягкая сила состоит из трех элементов. Первая – это культура, вторая – это политические ценности, а третья – это...
внешняя политика. И в чем вопрос?
Вопрос это, как вы понимаете эти три элемента?
Ну, культура, это, естественно, взаимодействие с культурой, там различные культурные мероприятия, там разные там выступления там тех же артистов. Так, еще второе повторите.
Политические ценности.
А политические ценности, ну это, например, распространение разных ценностей. Отчасти вот можно к распространению ценностей отнести такие ценности, как права человека, индивидуальная свобода.
Да?
Там свобода слова, совести, вероисповедания.
А третье?
А третье повторите.
Внешняя политика.
А внешняя политика, ну это сотрудничество с другими государствами, оказание там им определенной помощи, организация совместных проектов с этими странами.
Все верно. It's correct. Perfect. Yes, that's true. Is it clear for all of you? Yes, I think so, because not all of you are... Russian. Yes, basically yes, it's true. These are the three main elements of soft power. Okay, let's focus. This class is mostly focused to the first resource of soft power. Everything that is related with culture. According to Joseph Nye, it is possible to differentiate the two types of cultures: high culture and low culture. Popular culture. Well, high culture is everything that is related like with the elite. So, to a portion of population, this type of culture which is accessible to a specific portion, limited portion of population. This can be like everything related with university, because university is not open, not all the population starts at university. There is now the phenomenon of mass education at university, but it is still limited to a part of population. Not everybody studies at university. So everything that is related, connected with university, according to Nye, is classified as high culture. Low culture is more like popular culture, what is accessible to more people. So like movies, like serials or music, things that are also football, if you can consider it as a local, something that is accessible to all the population. And here there are the features according to some experts who studied this phenomenon of culture as a way who exerts soft power, there are some specific features of that. First of all, I wanted to stress that when we talk about soft power and education, there are two main terms that are used to express this feature. The first is the cultural diplomacy, the other is educational diplomacy. Both of them are rather similar, so there is no need to explain in details what is the difference. So everything, the results in educational policies, they always are measured, can be better measured in the long term. it is in the short term it's more difficult. Then we move to the third point. So educational and cultural policy are instruments to spread and are not instruments to explain and spread unpopular policy. So basically, this principle is rather simple. The idea is that you cannot promote or market something that it's not popular or that will not have the interest from people. Then let's move to the next feature. So it can contribute to facilitating the mutual understanding among the culture. So educational and cultural policies are a way to facilitate understanding between different cultures. Before I give the example of a European, or it can be the opposite, a Russian student that go for, one semester to Spain. This is a way to facilitate the understanding between the two cultures, the Russian and the Spanish one. It's a mutual way, because when a student goes there, for him it will be the occasion to understand better the local culture. But at the same time, when the student is there, we'll make friends, we'll make acquaintances with people there. So it's also a way to promote his or her culture in the other country. This is linked also with the next point. And another one that I wanted to stress is that it cannot be measured. This is it's difficult to measure soft power. It's not like in economics when you can measure the success of a product from how much money they have earned or how many. Items of that product you have sold in the market. When we talk about educational policy, it's much more difficult, it's much more complicated, because there is not really a way to measure that. And the last point is it needs to be creative, flexible, and opportunistic. So this is something, it's a rather flexible tool that the state can use to achieve a certain goals. Okay, in this slide you can see some educational programs that are used by some state. Do you know some of these programs? Okay, this is famous. And others?
Just Erasmus.
Only Erasmus. Okay. Do you know, have you ever heard about the Fulbright program? You know it?
Yes, I heard.
What's that?
It's like Erasmus.
If you get a scholarship, Fulbright.
No, I didn't talk scholarship, just it's in, I think it's in America.
Yeah, it's America.
You want to apply?
Yeah.
There's a site.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. This is the Fulbright is for the United States. So if somebody in the future would like to get a education in the United States is very expensive. So for those who would like to study in the United States, there are these scholarships called the Fulbright scholarship. But the purpose of this slide is to show that there are plenty of scholarship and educational programs that the states or international organizations use to promote education abroad. There is, for instance, the UK has developed this scholarship program, Netherlands has its own program, Japan has its own program, and so on. Really, France. Basically, almost all countries have developed some programs or scholarship to promote mobility and cultural exchanges. So this, they have developed their own strategy in educational policy. These are educational agencies, so institutions that states have created to promote their educational policies abroad. For instance, this one, DAD, is the German Academic Exchange Service. It's an agency of Germany, which is based in many countries of the world, also in Moscow, there is one. It is often attached to the cultural center. Okay, it's the German cultural center abroad. So for those who are interested in learning German or to go and spend a part of their education in Germany, Germany has developed this agency, which has this specific function. But this is the same. There is also in France a similar program, Campus France, which is attached to the French embassy. There is also one in Moscow. So is the purpose of Campus France is exactly the same as DAD. So promote education of international students to France. We have the German, we have Holland, Portugal, also Russia has one, Rostov-Luchensko. Maybe some of you know it. It's generally when we learn, we study soft power, it's always an example that it is used to express what are the agent, the bodies that Russia has for soft power, and this is one of that. But also Rostov-Luchensko, it's known by international students that are studying here, because to receive a scholarship and study in Russia, they benefit from scholarship of the Russian Ministry of Higher Education, which are allocated by, assigned by Rostov-Luchensko. Okay, regarding a comparative analysis of states that have developed their activities in cultural diplomacy. Here in this slide you can see a list of states. So the oldest country was started with cultural diplomacy is France, with creating the body Alliance Française in 1883. Is the oldest. And then this is an agency created by France, and is still existing, to promote French language and French culture abroad. So there is also in Russia, of course, and in many other countries of the world. And then there are also other countries. We have Italy, Germany, Hungary, and so on. So, but you can see the feature here that are pretty. Many of these agencies are quite old because they were established. Most of them here are before the Second World War. Here is during the Second World War in the 50s. And then there is a new wave in the 90s, where Spain, Portugal, Greece, Poland, Finland, they also created their own bodies to promote educational policy. So here, is, as you can see, it's mostly oriented to the Western countries. But in the we see that this is not limited to them, but there are also other regions of the world that are very keen, they've been very active in educational policies and in creating this agency active in cultural diplomacy. So we have India, United States, Brazil, China, Russia, South Korea. It's really this phenomenon of cultural education and soft power is something that it's really spread worldwide. It's not something that concerns only a few countries. Okay, when we talk about cultural diplomacy, generally when we study the institutional structure, so the bodies who are involved in cultural policy, we can identify different levels. It's a multi-level structure. This is the typical structure of countries, of nation states. So the principal is the government, and under the control of the government is specific bodies, the Ministry of Education and Ministry of Foreign Affairs mostly. So the political initiatives starts from the government, so from it's generally something centralized. And after that, all the activities of the cultural policy cultural policy are developed by specific agencies. There are agencies that promote cultural education, so to develop cultural events, to develop cultural activities like student exchange programs. And there are specialized agencies like DAD in Germany. But there are also another type of agency that promote cultural diplomacy. Are those specialized in the study of language? So here, for instance, the Goethe Institute. Goethe Institute, it's a body specialized to teach German. It is not specialized in developing mobility between countries. Of course, as a result, when you learn German, then it is easier to mobility, but it's not the first purpose of the study. And then at the bottom we have the third level, which are the beneficiaries. So generally are the universities, professors, students, citizens, and so on. So this is the structure, institutional structure of nation states. If we move to the European Union, which is not a nation state, an international organization is a supranational organization, you can define it as you prefer. The structure is it's a little bit more, there is an additional level, which is the supranational level, so the European Commission, let's say of the European integration process. We have some different agents. We have the European agencies specialized in education is the first type of body. The second are the nation states and their own agencies specialized in higher education matters. And the third is the EU delegations and Erasmus offices abroad. So here the difference between here and here is that here the impact is it is at European Union level. Here is at non-European Union level. These are like the EU delegations, as you may know, are the diplomatic bodies of the European Union. The European Union has EU delegation, like its own embassies all over the world. There is in Moscow, there is in India, China, Brazil, United States, and so on. It's like the diplomatic body of the European Union. Also, this diplomatic body of the European Union is a way to spread educational policies of the European Union in third countries, no? So it means not the European Union states. And then, as in the previous slide, there are the beneficiaries, which are schools, universities, NGOs. So these are the organizations that get money from the European Union. And through them, this money of projects and of scholarship is accessible to the beneficiaries, which are students, professors, public, citizens, and so on. So here we have a structure a little bit more complex because of the nature of the European Union, which is not a nation state. Okay, so now we move to the next section of this the lecture of today. So it's the European Union programs has a tool of soft power. So now in this part we are going to analyze more in details what the European Union does to promote its soft power to other countries. It's like to promote European values abroad. Okay, let's first have a look to the evolution from a political level of education at regarding the European Union. So the first question I wanted to ask, just to understand what is your understanding and I don't know, to understand that how to deal better with this topic. The European Union, when it was established? Когда был создан Европейский Союз?
Ну, это неоднозначный
вопрос. Когда начинали процесс евроинтеграции?
А начинался он просто где-то в 50-х годах 20 века. Ну и постепенно из разных союзов вот создавался Евросоюз и путем включения туда разных других стран.
А do you know, потом по-русски, you know who were the first states that were involved in the integration process of the European Union? Then? Yes.
But Germany?
Yes. And the last one? Maybe two, yes. Какие были государства, которые создали, начинали процесс евроинтеграции?
Ну это Германия, Франция, так, еще надо подумать.
Это шесть, да?
Не, я только две назвал.
Да, правильно.
Италия, может быть.
Да.
Бельгия тоже может быть.
Да?
Но я не уверен.
Да, это правда. Нидерланды, да? И там, вы уже сказали все. Люксембург, Бельгия, Нидерланды, Италия, Франция, Германия. Окей. Why these countries? Basically, the European Union was a way to solve the political problems. Because it started, the process of the European integration started after the Second World War. So it's a period when Europe was completely destroyed after the war, and they had to solve economic and political problems. Economic, yes, because then everything has to be started from after many years of war, so the economy of all the countries were almost collapsed, and then also political problems, because historically there were always conflict between European countries, especially between France and Germany. The First World War started mostly because there were conflicts among these two countries, and the Second World War also, there were conflicts between France and Germany. So the European Union was the idea of establishing starting this integration between countries was to overcome problems among political problems among countries. And how to do that? Basically, France and Germany, they always started many wars among them because they wanted to control some rich region between them, the rural region, which were full, that were rich of natural resources like gas, carbon, which were steel and carbon, which were used for the industry. So, controlling this region between France and Germany, it means wealth, it means industrialization, but it also created some conflicts among the countries. So the way to pass this problem is to create an international organization that would have been in charge of viewing and controlling the trade and the production of these natural resources. So we see that so the European Union process started in the 50s, and education is not one of the topics of interest of the European Union. Because the European Union was created like a political and economic organization to solve basically political and economic problems, and education was not one of that. At the beginning, the European Union was not interested in mobility of students and such kind of things. So, in the political agenda of the European Union, education was not mentioned when it was established. This was until 1987, when it was developed the Erasmus program. The Erasmus program is a mobility scheme program which allows students to study in another country. At the beginning, the Erasmus program was only focused on the European Union. So basically, a French student could study for one semester or one year in another European university. For instance, Germany, UK, Italy, Belgium, doesn't matter, to study in any other European university and then come back to his or her home university and to finish the study. This is a way actually to facilitate the mobility between the European Union. You know that the European Union, it was created also as a single European market. A single market where which is characterized by some features. One of the main features of the European single market is the freedom of movement. What does it mean, freedom of movement? It means that people, capitals, goods, everything should move freely inside the European space. For instance, maybe, yes, a lot of you have heard about Schengen. Schengen regime is a way to facilitate the movement of people within the European Union. So once that you are in the Schengen zone, Schengen area, you can travel without visa, you can without your passport, just with your identification document. You can travel to any countries of the European Union, and there are not checks. There is not a policeman that is going to check if you're moving from France to Belgium. The barriers do not exist anymore. Now with migration, the checks are, unfortunately, they are starting in some parts. But generally, if you take a plane from Paris and you go to Berlin, when you arrive in Berlin, you don't have to show your documents because you are in the Schengen area. The same is valid for third countries, like for Russia. So if a Russian citizen wants to travel, go to Europe and has a Schengen visa, the Russian citizen arrive in, for instance, in Paris, and once that he or she is inside the Schengen area, can travel without any additional documents to other Schengen countries. This is the free movement of people, but it's not enough to have a single market. The single market is much more. It's also the freedom of trade. So if there is a product that is produced, for instance, in Italy, let's imagine you produce bags, shoes, clothes, these products should be sold freely to other European countries without putting barriers. Without putting administrative barriers or economic barriers. Good thing is that you can the number of customers is much, much larger. One thing that is considered negative is that there is more competition. Because when you are in a big market, you have to be better than others. So you have to always to try a way to have products that are cheaper or or better quality than others, because otherwise you will not survive in that market. In the past, when countries had some power to regulate trade, so even they could use this political measure to regulate that. For instance, if Italy was producing bad cards, Fiat, a way to defend the single Italian market was to put the increase the costs on importing cards from other countries, from France, from Germany. So at the end, the price of French and German cards was higher than Italian cards, and Italian customers could decide to buy either a bad car, Italian car, cheaper, or an expensive German or French car, but of better quality. Now, in the European single market, within the European area, this is not possible anymore. So all the barriers are almost abolished. And this also, the single market, it's also spread to different areas, not only the movement of people and goods, but also of capital, so money can circulate freely, and also services. Education, you understand well that when the European single market was developed, so also it was the free movement of workers. So a specialized person living in a European country can easily find a job in another European country. You understand well that if you have a person that received a diploma in a European country, like let's imagine in Spain, and the Spanish person would like to continue to work in France, it's important that the diploma that he received in Spain would be recognized easily in other European countries, because if you do not recognize it, the result is that you do not have a single market. You have you still have some barriers. So the European Union, it started as a project focused on economic matters, but then as a spillover effect, it started to deal with other topics, and one of them was education. So education is a way to complete the single market, and also some people also see it a way to create a European identity and European citizen. There is a big debate about that. Does it exist a European let's say identity, European people? It's an open question. It is true that we cannot really talk about European citizenship, because inside Europe there are big differences between countries. So a French person is completely different from a Greek person, a Polish person is different from a Spanish person, and so on. So it's really difficult to talk about European culture, because the differences among countries still exist, they appear, but maybe some European values, they are trying, it's one of the purposes of the European Union, to promote them. And let's say education, according to those who support the Erasmus program or other educational programs at the European level that try to facilitate mobility inside the European Union, are oriented also in creating and developing a kind of European identity. So here we have other important phases of the European integration process is the Maastricht Treaty. Maastricht Treaty, it's famous because from that it officially started the creation of a single European currency. It's from that it started the euro, currency euro, lira. It started to be developed, and then after 3 years adopted in many European countries. So this is also another milestone of the European integration policy, to develop a single currency that it is widely used by many European states. So reducing the barriers between the currencies. So having one single currency facilitates the trade among the countries, because you don't have to pay anymore the exchange rate and fixed levels. In the field of education, this is a crucial year, 1999, because it is the year of the Bologna process. Maybe some of you have heard about that Bologna process. This is a process that is developed at the European level, but it involves also other regions and countries. One of them is also Russia. Russia participates in this process. The idea of the Bologna process is to create a European space of higher education, where diplomas can be faster and better recognized among the countries. Here in Russia, you have the structure bachelor, master, and PhD. This is a three-level education. Now, almost all the countries that participate in the Bologna process have adopted this structure. Also, Italy has adopted. In the past, there was not this three-level structure. There was, in the past, bachelor and master were part of a single educational program. After the reform of education, they've been split, and we have adopted a three-level structure. And then the last two phases of the development of the European cultural policy or educational policy, let's say, are the Lisbon strategy and the European development strategy. So basically, the European Union has other international organizations, also similarly to nation states, has its own strategy of development. So when they develop policies, they also have a programmatic document, which is it's how they see the development of that country or of that international, of that organization in the next, let's say, 5, 7, 10 years. And these are the political strategies that were adopted. This one in 2000, the Lisbon strategy, and this is in 2010, Europe 2020 strategy. Now the European Union is developing new strategies for the next 7-10 years. Okay, I spoke already about the Erasmus program, just very quickly. It was established in 1997, and at the beginning it was a mobility tool to link all the European countries. With the years, the Erasmus program has developed, and now it's involving all the regions, almost all the regions of the world. That's why it is considered as a tool of soft power of the European Union. So it is a way that the European Union uses to promote its values, its political, economic, and civic values to other regions of the world. And yes, the main rationales of the Erasmus program are political, economic, and civic. Political, because yes, it's a way for the European Union to promote its values. Economic, because it's also a way to facilitate, to boost the economic development of European countries. Investing on education, it is considered by many states as a way to improve the economic situation of a country. So if you have specialists, qualified people, it's a way to improve the economic of a country. And civic is what I mentioned before, is a way to create like a sort of a European citizenship, European common European identity among European young people. Yes, the Bologna process is also something I mentioned before. This is an intergovernmental process. Intergovernmental, it means that this is an agreement between the governments of the European countries. is not something that is directly controlled by the European Union, but it is controlled by the countries independently. And it is a pan-European process. It means that this is not limited to countries of the European Union, but it's much more. So you see, in the Bologna process, there are involved also the regions like the, which are not part of the European Union. We have Russia, we have Kazakhstan, we have Ukraine, we have Belarus. You see, this is really a process that involves 48 member states. And all these 48 participating countries of the Bologna process are in common the way that the work to achieve some specific goals in their agenda related with education. And there is also an external dimension of the Bologna process. This is to boost attractiveness of the European higher education, so it's a soft power. What is the idea? The idea is that if it is developed a common educational system in this area, the education here, it will be more attractive in becoming an important actor in higher education. So they are attracting more and more international students. United States is historically is the country that attracts the highest number of international students. If you check at the statistics of UNESCO, United States is the number one in the world in attracting international students. But there are other interesting regions which are very, very competitive in the world market of higher education. Australia is one of the one countries that attract a lot of international students. New Zealand also performs quite well, and also Canada. So the idea of creating a European higher education, common education system, it's a way to make the European educational space more attractive with other regions of the world. Okay, the Maastricht Treaty, I mentioned before, it's the treaty of 1992, which is famous because from it started the process to adopt a European current common currency, euro. But it is also famous because it facilitated some important reforms in the European Union. So this is from the point of view of higher education, the Maastricht Treaty is the treaty which recognized education officially as one of the competencies of the European Union. And also gave to the European Parliament formally gave some powers in regulating and adopting decisions through the co-decision procedure in the field of education. It is also important the Maastricht Treaty because in this period there were launched some new educational programs. So we have seen the Erasmus program in 1987, but in the 90s there were adopted new programs. So like the Jean Monnet program, which is related with this lecture. Then we have the Tempus program, which is, I will show it to you in the next slides. It's a technical assistance program. So it means that through education, the European Union tried to support the countries needing some economic support. And also the Alpha program and so on. Like this. So let's have a look to the Tempus program. Tempus program is a program of the European Union, is a soft power program, Tempus is the acronym for Trans-European Mobility Program for University Studies. So as you can see, we have the European Union countries and other regions of the world which are in green. At the beginning, when it started in the 90s, this Tempus program, it only involved it was addressed to the Eastern Europe, Central Eastern Europe. Actually, it was a way to integrate the countries like Poland, Czech Republic, Hungary, Bulgaria, Romania, after the fall of the Berlin Wall. So it was a technical assistance program of the European Union to develop, from the economic and the educational point of view, countries which were in a difficult period after the collapse of the Soviet Union. And also Russia became quite soon a country beneficiary of the Tempest program in 1994, so 3 years after the collapse of the Soviet Union. Then rapidly the Tempest program was extended to other neighboring countries of the European Union. You see, we have the South Mediterranean countries, some countries here in the Middle East area, in the Western Balkans. So this is an instrument of the European Union of soft power to control and to try to support the neighbor regions. The idea is that if in the neighbor countries of the European Union the economic and political situation is stable, it's good, it is also positive for the European Union. So this also kind of explain why the European Union should pay using the money of the European taxpayers to finance educational and economic activities in the neighbor countries. Because at the end also it will be also create some positive effect for the European Union, the European countries, and their global. Okay, the Giappone program is also another European Union soft power tool. Okay, do you know Giappone? Have you ever heard about this person? Good night, Giappone. Okay, it doesn't matter. Giappone is one of the father of the European integration process. He's of the people who was the first to theorize the idea of the European Union, but also in practice. He facilitated the start of the European integration process. So, it's, let's say, it's considered one of the father of the European Union. And the Giappone program takes its name because it's a program that is oriented in teaching and researching the European Union. So basically the European Union gives money to universities and professors to develop some teaching activities which are focused on the European Union. So this, the course that we are delivering here at Rudan University is in the framework of the Giappone program. So it's a way to introduce in the curriculum of universities some subjects related with the European Union. This is, as you can see, this program, it's open to all countries of the world. So in red you can see the countries that have at least some Giappone projects. You see that yes, the European, American continent is almost fully covered. The Eurasian region also is covered in many parts. Australia, it is. Some regions which are less covered are Africa, Middle East also, very, very few projects. And also here in the Oceania region, very few. But it's quite effective tool that the European Union has developed since the 90s to promote European studies. As the Erasmus program, the Giappone program at the beginning had only an intra-European dimension. It means that it was only oriented to European Union countries. Then, after a few years, it was open to other regions of the world. And it is in that period that the project, this program, assumed a like a soft power dimension. When it started to be open to other regions of the world. Okay, let's talk briefly about the Lisbon strategy. The Lisbon strategy is, as I mentioned before, is a strategy that it was developed by the European Union in the year 2000. And as you can see from the slogan, here is growth and jobs working together for European future. So basically, the idea is was that the European Union wanted to create a strategy to spend in let's say clever way the money to facilitate the economic and social growth of the European Union in the next year. So it is a program launched in 2000 and it had a perspective of 10 years. The idea of this Lisbon strategy was to boost the economic growth of the European Union, mostly giving a considerable part of the resources to education and research. So investing more money in this part. That's why this program it's considered very important when we talk about educational policies of the European Union. And also in this year there were developed new educational programs of the European Union, which were important tools of soft power. So Asian Link project program started in 2002, Alban project that is oriented to Latin America, and then Erasmus Mundus in 2004. Erasmus Mundus is a scholarship program that the European Union has started to create some master programs, international master programs, where students can study for all their master studies in Europe. So if you are a bachelor, are you studying the bachelor degree?
Yes.
Yes, so if you don't know where to study in the master degree, one option would be to study in an Erasmus Mundus program. Erasmus Mundus it's good for two reasons. One, it's a scholarship program. So when you apply for a master, you should, it can be interesting if you apply as a scholarship. The scholarship is pretty good because they give money to cover almost all the costs in the European countries. Some countries are very expensive. Finland, UK, really, really expensive. So this program covers all the tuition fees, so you do not have to pay for education there. You don't have to pay for living there, and they also give you the money for travels. Because one feature of the Erasmus Mundus is that you do not go to study one single university. The idea is that there is this idea of mobility, so you can study one semester in France, one semester in Germany, one semester in Finland, or one single diploma, which is recognized in all the countries where you lived, or double or multiple diplomas. So each university gives you a diploma. You have like a French diploma, Spanish diploma, German diploma. So it is when you would like, for instance, to work in one of these countries, you already have the diploma and you show that you have studied and you have worked there. So this is one of the soft power instruments of the European Union. Why? Because it's open to basically students from all over the world. So in an Erasmus Mundus program and enroll students from America, from Japan, from Russia, from India, from all the regions of the world. And then other programs that were developed are a Greek program and a lifelong learning program. Yeah, basically, yes, I explained already what is Erasmus. You see that Erasmus Mundus, you see that the dimension is really global. because you have mobility flows from all the regions of the world. In some cases, the education is not only limited to European Union countries, but also Russian universities, Brazilian universities, American universities can participate here. So also a part of education through this program can also be in the United States, Canada. It depends if this university participates in the program. It depends on the program a student is applying for. And then this is Europe 2020 strategy. This is the current strategy that the European Union has. It was launched in 2010 and it will last until 2020, so it's almost finishing. The European Union actually now is developing the new budget for the new years, and it's also developing the new strategy of growth for the next years. Just for your information, I explain you briefly. The Europe 2020 strategy is based on three main pillars. Which are political growth, are smart growth, sustainable growth, and inclusive growth. So the idea is that the European Union from 2010 to 2020 should, of course, have a growth, but it should have some specificities. So smart, so having more attention on innovation and technologies. So taking modernizing the so having its the development should be in line with the technological challenges and innovation that are occurring at global level. Sustainable, taking into account also the growth should be sustainable also from an ecological point of view, environment. The European Union invests a lot of resources in climate change and everything what is related with the environment. So also in this dimension it's rather important. And inclusive is the social dimension of growth. So basically it's like to diminish as much as possible the differences, the social differences between rich and poor people. So the growth should help, but also not to increase the differences between those who have more money, those who have less money. Okay. I think with this, we have the last few slides, and then it's over for today. So here you see that what are the main targets of the European Union 2020 strategy. So we have here, employment, it's one of the main targets, so increase the employment. So that after the last economic and financial crisis that hit a lot some European countries, the employment rate was very high, especially in the southern European countries, Spain, Italy, Greece, Portugal, have very, very huge unemployment rate. So one of the main challenges of the European Union is try to reduce that. So employment is one of the main targets strategy. The second is research and development. So investing more and more money on research. If we compare the statistics, the European Union still invests less than other international competitors in research and development. If we compare with the United States, Japan, also with China, the European Union is lagging behind. So one of the main challenges and its integrative part of the agenda of the European Union is to increase the its engagement in research and development. Then we have climate change and energy sustainability. So one of the main challenges and areas in which the European Union is involved is on everything that is connected with energy efficiency and try to struggle against the climate change. It is since the European Union is very active also at international level, your forums or in all international negotiations where states have to talk or to discuss about the gas emission, about pollution and so on. And then, yes, the fourth pillar is education. We have talked about that. We have analyzed some programs of which the European Union is involved. And then fighting poverty and the social exclusion. So here is yes the inclusive dimension of the growth of Europe. Okay, and then this is I think the last almost. So it is based on the Europe 2020 strategy. It's based on yes, the three main paths of growth. So we have the smart growth, sustainable growth, and inclusive growth. And the, all of them, they are characterized by some flagships in initiatives. So we, for instance, when we talk about smart growth, digital Europe, so it's investing more and more on digital on innovation, technologies, innovation, put on the move, and that's all. And the last point is the Erasmus Plus program, which is one of the main initiatives of the European Union in the field of, is the core educational program of the European Union during this strategy, is the Erasmus Plus, which is, it will last until 2020. Then from 2021 to 2027, there will be a new educational program, probably we call it simply Erasmus, so there will be different, the new possibilities for students study in the framework of the scholarship scheme in Europe. It will start in the next 2 years. And in the Erasmus Plus program, the global dimension of the European education is enhanced, so it's more in comparison with the previous programs. Okay, that's everything.